Hello, fishing friends. Welcome to another episode of The Fishing Podcast. I'm your host, Landon DeKaiser, and this is where I interview industry greats, average Joes and Janes, biologists, conservationists, and everything in between. My goal is simple. I want to inspire anglers to catch more fish, more places, more often. Welcome back, everybody. This week, I have John McMillan joining us again. He was on the show in season one, and I wanted to have him back because last year's conversation was super interesting, and we only covered just a small little bit of the topics that I wanted to cover with John. So John is a scientist that has been studying trout, salmon, and steelhead most of his life. He's been fishing for steelhead for over 40 years. So we just kind of talk about the current state of what's going on in the West Coast right now, what their steelhead runs looked like this year, how their fishing season was, which obviously was cut short with the COVID situation. So we get some updates there and then just talk about some interesting facts about some dam removals and how they have seen those affect fish out there on the West Coast in really a very short period of time. The episode's really just filled with all kinds of interesting facts about trout and salmon and steelhead. I could literally sit and talk to John for hours and hours and hours. He's an incredibly knowledgeable dude. He's got his own podcast now as well that is called the OP Fishing Podcast. It's incredibly interesting. I've listened to a good handful of the episodes already, and most of it is West Coast related, but if you're just interested in fish and science and biology, definitely check it out. There's a whole bunch of tactic related information and, you know, how to catch fish and what he's looking for, and great interviews with a variety of guests. So yeah, definitely check out the OP Fishing Podcast. I'll put a link to that show in the show notes. And if you want to follow John on Instagram, look up Rainforest Steel. He has a lot of incredible imagery that he then backs up with usually very lengthy and informative posts on information on about whatever he's doing research on or what he's thinking about. And I've learned a lot just from following his Instagram as well. So yeah, I really hope you guys enjoy this one. Thanks for tuning in. Here we go. Hey John, how you doing tonight?
Good. How about you, Landon?
I'm doing all right, all things considered. We talked earlier about the whole COVID scenario, and we're all still alive and well, so we won't have to delve back into that and have our listeners go through that whole painful conversation we've all had too many times. But anyways, I'm glad to have you back on the show. Had a blast talking with you last time, and have really been enjoying the podcast that you're working on now. You know, I guess a good place to start here is how'd your steelhead season go this year?
You know, yeah, thanks, Landon. So great question. So, you know, it's funny because I live here in Washington State in the Pacific Northwest, and we were one of the first states, you know, as we had talked about earlier, to kind of get hit with one of these breakouts of the coronavirus. And so I'm excited today because tomorrow on May 5th, I actually get the fish for the first time in 2 months because the state closed down all our fisheries. So I'm pretty excited and chomping at the bit to get out on the river responsibly, of course, right?
Yeah. I don't know if I've went 2 months without fishing in like, I don't, maybe ever. So that's,
no, I mean,
that's tough.
You're right. I had to go back to 1992, like one of my years in college when I just, you know, during the winter months when I lived in places where there was basically no fishing during the winter. And I, you know, that would be about it. But yeah, it was a long time. I had to go back over 20 something years to find a period where I'd went this long without fishing. And it was tough because they've also closed down all the state parks, all the boat launches. So it was even hard to go find a place to snorkel the river because so much of the land was closed down. But I'm really excited for it to open. But getting back to how our steelhead run was on, I live up on the Olympic Peninsula, you know, home to some of those giant steelhead. It's kind of a destination for many people to want to come winter steelhead fish. And the last few years, our runs, our returns of winter steelhead have been pretty poor to the OP. Some of the worst runs on record. And our data for run sizes goes back to about 1978. So it's a pretty long record, but it doesn't go back into the 50s and 60s, right? But yeah, a couple years ago, you know, we had some of our lowest returns on record. They're looking very poor again this year. In fact, this year, the projections for our runs were so poor that to be proactive, the Department of Fish and Wildlife closed down some fishing very early in the season on some of the very favorite rivers people had out here in Grace Harbor and the Chehalis. About a month and a half later, they ended up closing most of the coastal rivers. They didn't open the Skagit River CNR fishery, which we had hoped to have this year. And so basically, by the time the end of February came around, four or five rivers on the west end of the Olympic Peninsula were almost the only places open for fishing. So everybody was aggregated here. I mean, it was a tough time, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because there weren't a lot of fish around. There were a lot of people. Some of that self-regulates because, you know, the fishing isn't that great, so some folks go home.
Yeah.
But I would say, you know, I mean, as an angler, it kind of sucks to have these bad years, but as somebody who's been steelheading for over 40 years, I've come to accept that that's just kind of the, you know, that's kind of the way the ball bounces at times. It seems like as anglers, we're almost like professional gamblers. You know, you get these great hot streaks where the runs are really good for a few years and the fishing's awesome. Then we kind of go back to some normalcy. And then every now and then we have these crappy returns. And so it hasn't been that good. And it looks like there's probably, based on what we're seeing overall on the West Coast, it looks like there might be some kind of ocean issues going on because it looks like the OP is not like isolated in its bad returns. There's been other places where the runs have not been very good.
Do you see, so, have you seen any in the past, I guess to put it in perspective, how bad are the runs? Are they the worst they've ever been? Have you seen this before? How could you kind of quantify
that? Yeah, good question. So we can go into a place like the Quileute River watershed, which is home to the Salduck, the Bogashiel, and the Kalawa. So it's got three big rivers that encapsulate that watershed. And when I first moved up here in 1997, 98, 99, the first 3 years I lived up here, the run sizes were around 18 to 23,000 fish, lots of steelhead. And run size in 2004 were pretty similar, and then they kind of got a little bit lower as you go on through time. But now we're down to like run sizes of 7,500 to 9,000 fish. Hmm. So like about less than half of what we had in the good years. The worst runs were down there around that 7,500 fish level. You know what I mean? Very small. Almost, you know, at that point, almost actually just 25%, almost, you know, 30% of what it was in our good years. So that's what we're seeing are some really poor returns. But again, it looks like there's something bigger going on. So if I step back a little bit, for example, this past summer, the summer steelhead returning to the Columbia River and the Snake River had its worst returns on record. And that record goes back a long ways because they've had dams in those rivers. And the Skeena River up in northern British Columbia returned one of its lowest returns on record, they estimate. And so it looks like Washington, British Columbia, you know, something appears to be happening out in the ocean because there's a big, broad swath of the region that's had poor returns of wild steelhead over the past few years. And on the other hand, when you get into Oregon, especially like California and southern and coastal Oregon, those places don't seem to have, those populations of fish have done better than what you would expect relative to what we're seeing further north. And one reason that might be is that fish from the Columbia and Washington and BC, all those steelhead, when they hit the ocean, they tend to go north. And hit that area up in, you know, Alaska and way off towards Russia, while the steelhead in southern Oregon and California go out into the Humboldt Current. So they don't go really far north. So those different ocean currents that kind of break up the south and north of that steelhead distribution in the ocean, those currents tend to operate on different cycles. So when one of the ocean areas is more productive, the other ocean area becomes less productive. So gotcha. It could be that we're in this big picture where the northern Pacific is just not being very productive ocean-wise. We're seeing, you know, poor returns of some kings and sockeye in certain rivers and steelhead, chum salmon. And then in the southern area, though, it appears that the survival has not been as bad. And those places might actually be doing a little bit better than they had been doing. So it does vary, though. You know, it's just crazy to think that there's this big ocean out there and we don't know a whole lot about it, right?
Yeah.
In terms of where the fish go, what food they actually need to survive. But it wasn't a great year. You know, this is one of the poorest years that I've had catching up here. I always love being out to fish.
Sure.
It was a tough year, too, because most of January was really wet. So we had lots of high water in January. We're fishing, you know, in a foot and a half of visibility. The river's almost, it's a high water, right? It's up into the reeds and the willows. And we were fishing a lot during those conditions.
Yeah, it's tough.
Tough year, man. It's a tough year. And the forecast for us in the OP doesn't look any better for the next couple of years. It looks pretty similar. And so you kind of go through these periods. Like I was born and raised in the Columbia River Basin fishing for steelhead. And in the early to mid 90s, the population of steelhead crashed. Ocean survival was very bad. And I thought steelheading was done for. I basically packed up and moved to Montana to become a trout fisherman for the rest of my life because I thought steelhead were going extinct. But about 2 years later, I packed up. I couldn't stay in Montana as much as I love trout. I mean, I do love trout fishing, but they weren't steelhead to me. They weren't the fish that I was raised to love. And so I moved back. And in 2000, the ocean conditions picked up. And in 2002, 2003 and 4, we had some of the best ocean survival that we have on record too. So you kind of roll with the punches on these, right? Mm-hmm. You know, the better ocean conditions will come back. But I am worried because at the same time as people see, you know, there's with climate change and other factors, it's possible that we're seeing changes in like the pH of the ocean as things get warmer. And so it's possible that some of those effects are starting to manifest themselves too. Just as the ocean warms and the water chemistry changes, it can make it less favorable for salmon and steelhead.
Yeah. And, you know, a lot of people, when you even say climate change, they automatically get defensive and try to say, you know, oh, there's no such thing as climate change. But I was listening to a podcast the other day with, I don't know if you know who Matt Sapinski is. He lives here in Michigan.
Yeah,
he's authored a handful of books. But he put it really, really well. Because, you know, for my listeners, if there's people that are like, climate change isn't real, the way that he put it was something along these lines. Climate change is real, and it has been happening for, you know, forever. The climate does change. You know, how humans are impacting climate change is really the question. You know, are we destroying our planet? Or, you know, is this stuff going to happen regardless of what we're doing today? And I think that's the big question, and there's so much unknown there still. But with what you're seeing right now, and, you know, you're saying something's going on out in the ocean that seems to be causing these bad returns. Is there by chance anything that you can correlate that back to, you know, if you look at ocean conditions or any type of metrics that were taken on the ocean back, when did you say the runs were really bad? In the 90s?
Yeah, in the 90s. Absolutely. And that's a good question. It's funny, you know, I know Malin. I think he's at Rutgers now, right? Malin, I worked with Malin at the Wild Salmon Center like 20 years ago or so. It's crazy.
Okay.
That you read one of his papers. Yeah. And I'm with him. Like, I mean, regardless of what caused climate change, right? Whatever is happening, cause or not, the climate's getting warmer, right? Mm-hmm. Whether it's due to us or not, it could, you know, and we've certainly went through long-term cyclical changes in climate for long periods of time, right? I mean, we go into ice ages and come out of ice ages.
Yep.
In fact, when we got the first salmon species like 5 to 7 million years ago, they had to be resident because the ocean was really warm during that period. So most of the first salmonids that we had were basically freshwater obligate fish. They didn't go to the ocean. They evolved that later as kind of the climate cooled down and the ocean became more inhabitable. Now, we do have people like Dr. Nate Mantua, who's a researcher at NOAA and Southwest Fisheries Science Center in California out of Santa Cruz. And basically folks like him and others, people like Malin, have taken, in this case, Nate has taken ocean conditions, and he can go back a long ways in time, I think, to like the late 1800s, basically with these readings about ocean productivity. And so we can see that, you know, there's been these large scale ocean changes in productivity. The cycle that Nate first coined for one of these cycles was called the Pacific Decadal Oscillation. And basically about every 10 to 20 years, there's shifts in the cycles in terms of how strong the upwelling can be. Because I should probably be clear. So what generally happens in the ocean is there's two places the fish are likely to starve or actually experience mortality. The first place is as soon as they enter fresh water. So when the little juvenile steelhead and Chinook salmon or coho enter the salt, their body's going through a physiological change so that they can live in salt water because they've been in fresh water. And so that change is very stressful. And so when they get to the salt, they're usually feeding on the way out down the river. And then, of course, they need to feed again as soon as they enter the ocean to build up some of those energy reserves that they spent migrating down to the ocean. So the time at which those little fish hit the ocean is really important because that tends to occur in the spring. And in the spring, we often have ocean upwelling. And so that is the deep water from the bottom of the ocean that is really cold. That gets shoved up to the surface. And that has a lot of nutrients in it. It's very productive. And that helps feed all the little plankton and the various food sources that the baby salmon eat. So when I'm saying bad ocean conditions, it could be that the upwelling was really weak for a period of years. And that looked like what we had in the 90s. The ocean tends to get warmer, and the upwelling during the spring is weaker. And in the good ocean years, it's reversed. The ocean is colder, and we get more upwelling in the spring. The second place the fish can die, of course, is out there in the open ocean, right? That seems less likely in general. Most mortality that we identify in the ocean at this point occurs usually in that first month or two of life. But it's that first year of life fish tend to die. They might die, you know, as a juvenile, just trying to get the first food they get in the ocean. If the upwelling is really strong and lots of cold water, they're probably going to do well. But if it's the opposite, their survival will likely be worse. But then again, after they've made it out there, that first year in the ocean, they're going to be out in the big blue. Or in your case, you know, they're going to be out in these Great Lakes, and they've got to find food sources. And those food sources can be depleted. We've had this thing out in the North Pacific called the blob, which is like a big chunk of warm water.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that.
Basically resulted. Yeah. Go ahead, Landon. I don't want to. I'm sorry to ramble on here.
No, you're getting exactly what I was going to ask too. And I was just going to ask. You know, I remember talking about that last year, and there's this big blob of warm water. And one of the questions I had about that is it still there? And then the second question I had was, is the reason that cold water isn't coming up or upwelling just due to the vast temperature change, and it's hard for it to, you know, pass up through that incredibly warm water on the top?
Yeah, exactly. It has to do with the surface wind currents, basically, but also some of the recirculation patterns of the water underneath. And that's not my specialty, but as best I know, it is a combination of changes in wind currents and how those wind currents ultimately affect the distribution of that cold water. So you're right. Some years the cold water is just trapped under there. You know what I mean? And it can't rise to the surface. And other years it's allowed to rise to the surface. And that's a combination of the wind and then the water bodies itself kind of cycling throughout.
Now,
and we do still have the blob. Yeah, go ahead, Landon.
On the flip side of that, I mean, the West Coast and really the entire country last year, I mean, we got a lot of rain. It was a really, really wet year. Anywhere that you went, everybody that I talked to was, yeah, we have had a lot of rain. I mean, the rivers here last year were flood stages more often than they were at normal levels, like throughout the summer when water levels are typically super low. Do you think that warm water, that blob that's hanging out there, caused some of that rain, or was the reason for such a wet year?
Well, that's a great question. In fact, I don't know why. It just seems to me that our winters have gotten much more variable up here because the blob's been on and off out there for pretty much the past 4 to 5 years. Like last year, they thought the blob was going away and it dissipated for a bit and then it came back. But there's definitely this big warm water body out there, and they're seeing like dead seabirds and dead fish, right? It's a dead zone.
Really?
Out there, and it's really large. Yeah, I mean, we're talking, you know, tens to hundreds of kilometers wide. You know, this is a big I think it's hundreds, actually. It's a very large area in the North Pacific that's just gotten really warm. And
how warm is really warm? Do you know what they're measuring for surface temps?
Yeah, I can't remember off the top of my head, but often that north. So Steelhead and Salmon have thermal limits somewhere in that 50 to 52 degree range. Mm-hmm. In the ocean, 53, 54 before they start to move out. So once those water temperatures get up into that 54, 55 degree range, all it takes is a few degrees. It's amazing.
Yeah, they're going to prefer those colder temps.
Exactly. And so I can't remember what the actual temperature differences are, but it's not as much as one would think. You know, it's like 4 to 5 degrees difference, I think, 7 at most Fahrenheit. So it's gotten really warm. But then again, it's funny because that blob hasn't existed in that kind of southern part of the North Pacific where the California and Oregon fish, a lot of those fish go to. It's kind of ironic, right, that it's up there in the cold part where that cold area is. And it should be. I'm interested to see how this unfolds because there are scientists now. There's a fellow named Dr. Richard Beamish who's worked in Canada as a professor for a long time, and him and a bunch of other scientists are getting together and they're using acoustic tags and a bunch of other stuff, and they're basically starting to track more salmon out in the North Pacific to understand where they're going. Like, are different, we assume that populations from different rivers go to some different places in the ocean, but some populations likely share similar areas. So they're trying to figure that out.
Yeah.
It should be pretty cool, you know?
Yeah. That
I think
would
right
be really
now
cool.
It's kind of a guessing game.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a guessing game. You know, I don't know what the temperature does per se. You know, it speeds their metabolism. So it makes the steelhead need more food, and the more active they have to be in search of more food. You know, at some point you just burn the candle on both ends. And once a fish gets to about 1% body fat, they're kind of swimming dead.
Mm-hmm. Something I just thought of. So are they actually tagging these fish and then tracking them? Is that how they're doing this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, what they do is they put tags in them and then they put buoys out there. So they track them two ways. I think they track them through both, so occasionally through aircraft and boats, but I think most of the tracking is done through buoys that are out there that the fish swim by.
Okay.
So you get like a reading, you know, it's like a pit tag or yeah.
Now, so I don't know what the cost to do a test like this is, but I did a podcast with Nicole Watson, who is heading up our grayling reintroduction initiative, or she's a big part of it. I don't know if I can say she's heading it up for sure, but she's a big part of leading the research to be done in that. And when we did that podcast together, I'm probably going to screw up the name for this, she was talking about how they take the ear bone, which is called an obelisk. Did I get that right?
Odalisk.
Odalisk. I knew I was going to screw it up.
Odalisk. Yeah.
So
totally.
To put it in fisherman terms and not scientist terms, they shoot these things with a laser, and then they can tell, like, you know, by the particles or something, which rivers they come from.
Yeah.
It'd almost be interesting if they could get like the commercial fisheries out there to, you know, every day when they catch fish to send one or two in for research, or the heads or something even, because they wouldn't even need the whole fish. But then again, I have no idea what that cost to do that.
Oh, no, you know, that's a great question, Landon. So out here, what we do, and you actually, I always love, you're thinking of things that we're already doing, which means you think along the lines that are really applicable to me to managing salmon. So we do have a sense of where salmon go in the ocean, because the vast majority of a lot of hatchery salmon are tagged in the nose with what we call a coated wire tag. Mm-hmm. So when we catch those fish out in the open ocean, they wand all the fish to see where they're from.
Okay. That's a little easier way to do it.
It is. But it's hatchery fish, and I always tell you where the wild ones are going, but you're right. So with otoliths, we can tell from the ear bone, but so far they can't tell where the fish is going in the ocean with the ear bone. What they can say is where the fish was born and lived in fresh water, though.
Right.
And they can tell whether the fish went to the ocean or not, and whether it went to like a brackish water estuary or whether it went to the full ocean. But I think you're right. It's just a water chemistry difference, because that little ear bone is cartilage. And so every stage of its life, when it builds new cartilage, it uses that water that it's in, and that water chemistry becomes like a little signature in the ear bone. And so every time the fish moves a long distance or stays in a different habitat with very different water chemistry, it should show up in the ear bone. And that's how we've been able to look at, maybe we've looked at movements of juvenile coho and steelhead and chinook, and similar to, you could do that with grayling or anything. It's really, it's amazing, right? The little clues that the fish give us. And in fact, the problem with that is it's lethal, right? You got to yank the otolith out. And I did my grad work taking the otolith out of little tiny fish, and it's by, you know, it's a microscope, right? You know, for little ones. For the adults, it's pretty easy. You just scrape off the top of their head and pull these little things out. There's a new method that scientists have developed in the last 6 to 7 years, and it's still being tested. But it looks like what we can do is we can actually take, so you know the bottom fins, like the ventral fins on the belly of our fish?
Yep.
If you go right to where the fin, the front ray of that fin actually hits the belly, and if you take a clip there of the fin, right where the fin's base is, we can then analyze the water chemistry in the fin ray itself, because the fin ray leaves similar growth rings.
Oh, okay.
So
Absolutely.
So in the Elwha River, you know, one of the places that I work now where we had that big dam removal project, right? We had a bunch of rainbow trout that were locked above dams and couldn't get to the ocean for over 100 years. The two dams have now been removed, and we're starting to see lots of steelhead come back to the system. And so what we've been doing is using a bunch of different methods to figure out where these fish are coming from, genetics, otoliths when we find a dead fish. And then we're also testing that fin ray stuff to see if we can use fin rays, because the fin rays should be able to tell us whether that fish had a mom that was a steelhead or a rainbow trout.
That would be really interesting to see. And yeah, I remember talking about that too. And I think it was in one of your posts that you had posted on Instagram about how some of these steelhead are some of these rainbow trout are now going out to the ocean, it seems. Was that the case? Am I remembering that right?
They totally are. I mean, it's been amazing. So, you know, and summer steelhead are probably the coolest story in the Elwha, because, so yeah, the Elwha was basically dammed with two dams. It's about a 55-mile-long river, so it's not really long. But the upper 75% of the watersheds in the Olympic National Park is basically in pristine condition and protected forever. Two dams are removed. The lowest dam was at River Mile 5, had no passage. So all the anadromous fish that we had in the Elwha were in the lower 5 miles. And above the dams, we had piles of rainbow trout that were resident, and we had bull trout. And we also had a few invasive brook trout and some other invasive cutthroat, like Yellowstone cutthroat, a couple of those. Just a weird hodgepodge of fish that had been planted. But there were a lot of native rainbow and bull trout. you remove the dams. Before the dams came out, every year we were lucky to count like one or two summer steelhead. We would count about 200 winter steelhead. And now, only 4 years after the uppermost dam was been pulled, the summer steelhead population is up to 900 fish.
That's insane.
And it's now the single largest, population of wild summers, likely the single largest population in all the Washington coast and Puget Sound. In only 4 years, and genetics is telling us that a lot of those fish came from resident rainbow trout that were above the dams.
That's super interesting. Now, with those residents, when I say I caught a resident trout species, what I mean is it's a fish that lived in that river system. You know, maybe it wasn't native to there, but it's a resident. You know, it was born there. You know, not necessarily a hatchery fish. Maybe there's some hatchery genetics in there. You know, because there's been so much planting over the years, but a fish that grew up and lived in a river, that's its home. But did they do much planting of rainbow trout up in that system, or were they just kind of relics of what used to be steelhead before the dams were put in?
You know, another good question, Landon. So yes, there were a number of rainbow trout that have been planted there from other places. They planted lots of rainbow trout specifically from that McLeod River hatchery in California. So yeah, for a long time, for decades, they were Johnny Appleseed fish up into there. They had cutthroat from Yellowstone, cutthroat from Montana, Idaho. They planted lots of fish. And before the dams came out, there were three distinct populations of omicus, or rainbow trout slash steelhead. One below the dams, one in between the dams, and then one up above the very uppermost dam. And that was because they were all isolated and couldn't get to each other. And at that point in time, genetically, there was evidence of these other fish that have been planted in the system. But so far, with the information that we're seeing on the steelhead, it looks like they are, at least preliminarily, the data we have, it looks like those fish are not coming from the stocked fish that used to be here. And I think the last time any rainbow trout were stocked in the Elwell was probably in the 1980s, maybe early 80s. So it had been quite a while. But undoubtedly, some of these fish that we're seeing, though, are not pure Elwell fish. There have to be some that are coming back that have genes in them from rainbow trout that were planted here a long time ago from somewhere else.
So, and this is a crazy question that you probably don't know the answer to, or can't say for sure, but just, you know, if you had to answer it. So let's say you take a trout strain from Nevada or something, you know, these real inland trout that are not in any way, shape or form the steelhead that we know and love. But if you took those and you put them in a migratory river, do you think that they would start to migrate and their body shape and structure would eventually resemble more of a steelhead than those, you know, beautifully leopard printed rainbow trout that you see in like those West Coast mountain rivers?
That's a great question, Landon. And I do think generally you're right. I think that's what would happen. Of course, there would be some variation. For example, if I stuck that fish in a stream in Alaska where there's piles of sockeye returning and it's just got hundreds and thousands of pounds of eggs to eat, there is so much food, it probably won't migrate to the river, to the ocean anyway. You know, it'll probably just sit there and be fat. But most of our streams don't have that level of salmon returning to them anymore. So I do think you're right. I think you start to take rainbow trout, and we've seen there's some data on this. For example, you're right. These trout will eventually start going to the ocean. Their body forms will change as they undertake longer migrations, if that's possible. And there's some evidence for this out of Ontario, actually, where in Ontario, Canada, they've had rainbow trout that were planted decades and decades ago reach the ocean in the last 15 years, which is crazy, right? To think of steelhead being in the Atlantic Ocean now in Canada there. So I would be interested, right? I mean, I haven't heard the folks talk about what did the rainbow trout look like when they planted them versus what they look like now. But I bet you you're exactly right. I bet you undoubtedly those fish have changed, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because to swim that long distance, you're going to have to be more fusiform. You're going to have to be a better swimmer.
Yeah,
long distance migration than you. Yeah, you couldn't be a short fatty.
It's
or even a big thick fatty, right? It's just not going to work as well.
Exactly. Yeah. We'll definitely talk about your podcast a little bit, but listening to the episode, I think that you did with your dad, and you're talking about the diversity of steelhead, and how they can be so different from one river system to another. It seems like steelhead have an ability to, you know, evolve, you know, maybe with a small e, very, very quickly compared to many others. You know, fish species or even any type of species that inhabits the earth. It's really interesting to just see how fast they can change and how different they are from one river system to the next. You know, even right here in Michigan, it's pretty crazy.
No, I just could think we had something on our wildsteelheaders.org page, a blog post series that we did. If folks want to go back to that, it's wildsteelheaders.org. And we had a friend of mine, a scientist out of Ontario, Canada, write a couple of blog posts on the diversity of steelhead in the Great Lakes and the Canadian side. And it was shocking to me to see how much diversity. And I guess I shouldn't say it was shocking. That's a little overdone because I've known about this information. But it was the one example that he provided that was really fun to look at. So I think you're right, Landon. Steelhead, and I think they do evolve more rapidly than other species in terms of selecting what works for a river. And I think of the life history, the diversity is the fish are basically doing things in their life that get them to the point so they can survive and become an adult and reproduce. And so it's not uncommon for us to look in one watershed and, for example, on the Elwha River here, the population right now is about half summer run and half winter run. There's probably somewhere on the order of 32 to 38 life histories. If we go right next door to the Quileut River system, the population only has about 5% summer run, 95%, rather than kind of a 50-50 mix.
Mm-hmm.
And you're at about 30 life histories, but it's different. Those life histories, even though the numbers are similar, look different. So like most of our summer runs here return after 1 or 2 years in the ocean, but most of our winter runs return after 2 to 3 years in the ocean.
Yeah.
So the sizes are very different. And it's basically steelhead are tailoring their life histories to a given watershed. And because they have so many options, like they could smolt at age 1, age 2, age 3, or age 4, they can spend anywhere from a few weeks in the ocean up to 4 or 5 consecutive years. And all those options give them a lot of opportunity to, eventually select, right, for nature to kind of sculpt on it and work mm-hmm. and select the right ones. And so I think you're right, man. If you just took like a population of steelhead from one of your rivers and stuck them in a bunch of different rivers, what you're going to see is that all those steelhead after, 30 to 40 years are going to look very different. Those populations would be. And that's what I was struck by in the Great Lakes was that lots of fish were put into places from the same stock, right? Mm-hmm. There was a lot of Skamania stock there, but you end up with tremendous diversity 100 years later. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just the Great Lakes are an awesome example because look how different your fish look from our fish. And yet your fish came from our fish.
Yeah, it is really interesting. You know, you go, like, if you just take Lake Michigan, for example, which is the west coast of Michigan, you know, if you go farther south, you get a lot of the Skamania-looking fish. They're longer, they're skinnier, they're faster, they jump more. Not to say that there aren't, you know, big fat steelhead there too, but I seem to catch more of those Skamania type steelhead, especially in the summertime on the lake off the piers and stuff. And then the farther you go north, they get like the, you know, the bigger humpbacks on them, real thick fish. It's just interesting how they can change so much in this state, you know, let alone around the world. But that's the type of stuff that just continues to fascinate me. And I feel like there's no way you could ever learn everything there is to know about these fish, because the minute you did, they would change it up on you.
Totally true, man. I mean, I try and read as much as I can, and it doesn't matter. I mean, I can't study every population, right? A fish across the world. So you're right. I mean, we'll never know everything, right? I mean, but it's cool because the Great Lakes to me provide this awesome experiment, man. Just to see how fast these fish can evolve. And it's also been crazy to me to even see studies where the naturalized populations of fish, steelhead, that you all have in the Great Lakes, they've done studies to show that when you then put hatchery fish on top of them, that the naturalized populations can struggle, right? In other words, your fish have already evolved to take advantage of the ecosystems they live in.
Yeah,
it's just amazing to think. And they were derived from hatchery fish, right? This is what's crazy.
And that's right. That's to your point. That's just how fast it can change. And it is crazy. But, you know, what is your take on why the hatchery fish can kind of negatively impact the native fish that have been calling that river home and evolved to be there over the last, you know, 50 years, whatever it's been in Michigan? Well, I was going to say what my take on it was, but I'll let you go ahead and answer the question since I asked it. Why is it, do you think, that the hatchery fish cause a strain on, you know, the same exact type of fish, you know, maybe slightly variance in DNA or something, but like, what are some of the reasons that you think that could be?
Well, I think there are a couple reasons. I first think that the Great Lakes are interesting because the history suggests that what they first did was they planted lots of hatchery fish from lots of different places. And initially they didn't see a response like they wanted, like there weren't steelhead right away. Yeah. And so everybody kind of forgot about them, and they greatly reduced, in lots of cases, just stopped planting the fish in certain rivers. And lo and behold, like 20 years later, people are catching like really big rainbow trout. And about 5 to 10 years after those, they're catching steelhead. So what happened was they planted the hatchery fish, and then they stopped planting. They kind of let nature operate, you know, on those genes that you would that have been provided to the river. And I think all these hatchery fish probably have the ability, you know, if you dump enough of them in the river, some of those fish are going to have the genetics to survive there. So the challenge is then that those fish can do well on their own. But then when you start putting more hatchery fish on top of them, I think what happens is that there's a scale issue, is that in nature, most of these fish, basically what they've done is they've evolved different behaviors to get in and out of really high mortality places. So I'll give you an example. Up here where I live, most of the steelhead smolts out-migrate during the cover of darkness to the ocean, okay? Mm-hmm. And we don't exactly know why they do that, but the most likely explanation is that they're trying to avoid being eaten by like a warm-blooded animal, like a bird or an otter or a seal, you know, because those animals don't hunt at night because they can't see very well at night. So the fish immigrate out at night, but the hatchery steelhead smolts don't. They mostly out-migrate during the day.
That is interesting.
And it makes sense because they haven't spent 2 years in fresh water where they need to hide during the daytime when all the birds and stuff are out. You need to be very cautious, but then they learn to feed at night during certain times of their life when they're really susceptible to being eaten. So they just haven't learned how to survive, right? It's like sticking a preppy rich kid on the streets of Brooklyn in 1970 or in 80 and saying, good luck, survive. Amazing human being. But he doesn't know what it takes to survive on the street.
Right.
Right. And I think it's kind of like that. These fish just behaviorally are not used to predators. And so they think it's great. You can swim around all day long and nobody eats you. But in nature, they do eat you.
Right.
And so I think that what happens is you start planting lots and lots of fish every year, you know, hundreds of thousands. And so the natural population in a case up here might be producing 70,000 smolts. And if 2/3 of those out-migrate at night, only a small fraction are ever going to be are ever going to be out during the daytime to attract piles of predators. And I'm going to get a little long-winded here. I'm sorry. My point being is that when you continually plant lots of fish, those fish, because they're naive, because they've been raised in a hatchery, as soon as you plant them, they just don't have that survival instinct, you know? And that is kind of like letting all my chickens out of my coop, and I know what happened. My dog would kill them instantly, like all of them. So I think there's a scale thing that comes on. And so the long story short is that I think hatchery fish are prone to attracting lots of predators at times. And that can make things really tough for the wild fish. But I also think the other aspect is that the hatchery fish, like they did in Argentina and Chile, is it seems like the hatchery brown trout that escaped the fish farms and naturalized those rivers, it sounds like they just ate a lot of the native fish up and consumed them.
Was that in one of your podcasts that you were talking about recently about the brown trout?
Yeah.
And they ate all the food in the river, so then they just started migrating to the ocean eventually?
Exactly. That's the theory right now. Is they basically have watched the populations, the food supply of other fish and stuff just go downhill to the point where their population got so large that they had to start going to the ocean. It's crazy, right?
That is nuts.
So yeah. I think that there's that balance there, right? It's like hatchery fish is there's something about releasing them and letting nature operate versus continually planting them. And then when you do plant them, they can attract predators, they can eat other things. But then there's also just this novelty of an invasive species, Landon, that is outside my expertise. But there's something about species that come into new habitats where they've never been, and they dominate for periods of time. It's crazy, right? We see it with lots of animals. And I've read a couple papers on that, but frankly, I haven't read anything on it in like 10 years, so I feel like an idiot if I said something. But there's something to that whole concept, and part of that is the predation and prey thing. You know what I mean? Is that you get into this place, and these fish and other fish that have lived there are like not used to a brown trout that act like T-Rex.
Yeah.
Eat everybody, you know? They're like, oh my gosh. Not very scientific, sorry, man.
No.
It's fun to think about.
Yeah, I love just, some of the things we don't have answers to, having conversations on. Sometimes those are the most fun to talk about because no one's right or wrong.
yeah, I'm with you, man. Totally.
But so I watched the artificial documentary on hatcheries, which was incredibly, incredibly interesting. It kind of just goes along with what we're talking about now. And they talk, just about how negatively the hatcheries can impact the total number of fish. Now, that's one thing that's a really hot topic, right? Because as an angler, you want to go out and catch fish. Everybody says at least it's a beautiful day on the water, but let's be honest, that's just what you say when you're not catching fish. Anybody would rather go out and catch fish. There are people that that do just enjoy being on the water, and don't get me wrong, if I go out and don't catch anything, I still had a good day, but I'd rather catch fish. So I've talked to people that are strongly in favor of keeping hatcheries. And what's your take on the whole hatchery thing? If we just said, nope, hatcheries are done, and we just shut them all down, everywhere out on the West Coast, would things be better? Is this something that will take time? Do hatcheries still have their place if done right? And I just asked you like 100 questions at once, so if you could answer them all in 30 seconds, that'd be great. No, I'm kidding.
Totally,
brother. But just kind of trying to get what your take and input is on that.
Yeah, I think it's a fair question. I think it is a hot topic, and I know the movie came out and it did create some division amongst anglers. And I suppose my take on hatcheries is basically like most of my life is everything in moderation. Mm-hmm. Kind of always what my grandmother told me when I was sitting there and I wanted my third cup of hot chocolate. And she's like, no, I'm not going to give any more hot chocolate and watch a 5-year-old run around all popped up on sugar. So I look at hatcheries that we need a better balance. I don't think we've struck I think our contemporary balance in terms of hatchery use and where they're at on the West Coast is out of whack. And for example, in the state I live in, we have the largest hatchery infrastructure of any country in the world, let alone a state. Mm-hmm. So almost every major river in Washington state has a hatchery, or hatchery fish are released on that river from a hatchery in a nearby river. So the question is you look to the Great Lakes and you guys have, you know, hatchery rivers and you have wild rivers, and out on the West Coast, we almost mostly have just hatchery rivers. So even in the Great Lakes, looking from the Canadian side to the American side, you guys have in many ways struck a little bit better balance than we have. So I think we over rely on the technology of hatcheries. Now, it doesn't mean that I think they're all in all some evil, bad thing. And I don't think there's any single dial that we can turn that's going to instantly fix our salmon problem, because it is about cumulative impacts, and we've got 8 billion humans on the planet. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I say that. So my view of hatcheries is that I think the science is very clear. Hatchery fish have a myriad of negative effects on wild fish. I'm familiar with over 400 papers that show the various negative things that hatcheries do to salmon when they go in them, right? So hatcheries, we know, negatively change a fish. Now, when I say negatively change, I mean they impair that fish's ability to survive in nature. The fish survives well in a hatchery, just doesn't survive as well in nature. Now, that said, I think my perspective is that we find the right balance, and you do that through a pretty simple process, which is there's some places on the West Coast that have really good habitat remaining. And those places tend to have better populations of salmon and steelhead. For steelhead, I tend to think those are the best places for wild fish, that we don't need hatcheries there. On the other hand, we've got rivers on the other end of the spectrum that have been really degraded. They're often close to urban centers or cities, and those places don't have the capacity to produce populations of wild steelhead that will ever be recovered, not even enough to produce, to have a fishery. So I think those places are ideal places for hatchery production.
Okay.
And so I guess I look at it like that. You know, I would invest in hatcheries where I absolutely think you need them to have fisheries. And then where you don't need them to have fisheries, I think you maintain those as your wild strongholds. They're not national parks. You still fish them. But you're going to make sure and treat the habitat better in those watersheds too, right? They're like your Microsoft stock, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think that's how we move forward, because if we don't have a structure like that, in 50 years, every river is just going to be hatchery fish. And the problem with hatchery fish is that we just got done talking about diversity. So wild populations of steelhead may have 30 to 38 life histories, but a hatchery population usually has 2 to 3. And that's because they almost all smolt at the same age. And so hatchery fish are important, but so are the wild ones. And so I think I would rather strike a balance, you know. I think we can achieve a better balance than we do have. But I'm also pretty pragmatic, because it's unlikely that, you know, one movie or one science paper, it's not going to happen, that is going to change the direction of humanity's reliance on technology.
Right.
I mean, we do it universally. So I think hatcheries are part of that. I think they have a role. I don't see them as evil, but I think we can strike a better balance. And I'll give you a perspective, is that in the North Pacific, there's research out of Alaska, Seattle, that we are now planting more fish in the Pacific Ocean, more salmon than it sustained historically prior to European arrival.
No kidding.
And this is now having effects on pink salmon, on sockeye salmon in Alaska. In years when the ocean conditions are poor, there are so many hatchery pink and chum that they're eating all the food, and that's resulting in sockeye returning to Bristol Bay at a smaller size.
Huh.
So part of the bad ocean conditions are likely that we're just flooding it. You know, we can't, for example, on one hand, we can't see the ocean has a blob in it, and ocean survival is going downhill, and then plant it with 5 billion hatchery fish, right? I mean, that doesn't make sense. You've got to find the right balance. It's like, you're not going to stick 1,000 cows out in a pasture that's 5 acres.
Yeah.
It just can't support it.
Right.
And so at some point, I think that's the problem, is just the sheer numbers of fish. We're absolutely swamping the North Pacific with hatchery fish. And a lot of those are just pink and chum. And those pink and chum enter the ocean at a very small size, like an inch, inch and a half in size, 2 inches maybe. And they eat the bottom of the food chain. They eat all those small little plankton. And so the analogy or the metaphor that people have used is that those fish, those hatchery, there's so many being released, they're like the locusts before the cattle. You know, they're just like swarms of locusts out there is how they kind of talk about it. But think of this, is that most of those are pink and chum. Those aren't fish that are being harvested for meat that humans eat. They're only being harvested in most cases for eggs and caviar.
Right.
So I'd rather catch a sockeye or a chinook or a steelhead than I would have caviar from pink salmon in Russia. You know, because all these fish aren't being released from us in America. A lot of these are being released out of Japan and Russia. Although substantial amounts are coming out of Alaska. But I think we've talked about these are trade-offs, right? For me, I don't really care about caviar from pink and chum salmon. I want to eat a fresh chinook, sockeye, or steelhead.
I'd rather eat very little caviar in a year. Very little. Usually
yeah,
none.
Yeah, I'm not a caviar. I mean, I'll have a little bit of the stuff on sushi. It's not my taste. Right? I just enjoy catching my fish, and pink and chum are also about the two last species I want to go fish for as an angler.
Yeah.
I want to fish for chinook, coho, and steelhead. Those are my favorites. And so I look at it like that. You know, it's a balance between philosophies. My philosophy, I'd rather have less of those hatchery pink and chum, more big wild chinook and sockeye. And if you're going to produce more hatchery fish, put them more into the fish that we want to catch and not ones that we simply want to cut open for their eggs. And then the meat goes to dog food, you know?
Yeah. Yeah,
I think there's a balance, man. I don't think hatcheries are all bad, you know. And look at this. You guys have beautiful fisheries there because fish were planted there. You've got beautiful fish. On the West Coast, it's a little different because they're native, and so we're trying to work that out. I just think we need a better balance. And but I don't, you know, getting there is, you know, that's a difficult lift, solving it, right? I mean, I don't know that we've solved it in my lifetime or any lifetime. I think this gets solved through economics is my hunch, you know?
Yeah, and then, I mean, we were talking, what river was it we were talking about with the rainbow trout and the dam removals earlier?
Oh, the Elwha, yeah.
So the Elwha had some dams taken out, and you saw positive impacts from that immediately, or very quickly. So what's just kind of your perspective or outlook on the future of dams out there on the West Coast? You know, obviously power is essential. Everybody needs electricity. Hopefully we find better and more renewable resources for power here in the future. But what's going on with dam removal out there? Is there any new projects on the horizon on any of your big rivers to get some of that water flowing freely again?
Yeah, you know, it's a good question. So, you know, the Elwha stuff, two dams removed. There were a couple other smaller dams that were removed prior to the Elwha, but the next big project that is online is removal of dams in the Klamath River. I can't remember if it's four dams in the Klamath, I think, are being removed, proposed to be removed. It looks like that has been agreed upon, and, you know, Trout Unlimited has been playing a role in that, of course, but it's been a huge collaboration amongst people. And the Klamath is a very large river system that drains southern Oregon and northern California. So that project looks like it's going to come to fruition. And I think you talk, and then of course, I think, you know, there's a few other smaller dam projects, and you've got like the four dams on the Lower Snake. I think the four dams on the Lower Snake River are probably the most contentious right now, right? You know, Trout Unlimited, we've been working with a lot of people, you know, we're supportive of dam removal. But our tact in the Snake has been that removing dams is not just about rebuilding fish. It's also that we've got to make sure that the people that rely on those dams remain whole, right? So that we've got to take care of the farmers and get them water. We've got to find alternatives to barging. In other words, when you remove dams that are part of an economic infrastructure, you can't just remove them with no plan to replace
them. Right, and say, see you later, guys, right? Figure it out.
Yeah, you need alternatives. And I think TU is really good at that, you know, which is there's a human element to all of this, yep. You know? And I think that's where a lot of these debates get really heated is that, look, inside, I want more fish, right? That's what I love. I want wild rivers where I can go out and fish on them and, man, it's like going back in time. But that's unrealistic, but that's what I would like. There's other people that don't care about any dams, and they just want flood control and cheap electricity, right? Maybe right. Playing golf is their gig, whatever it is. So I think that's why it's important to make people whole. I would say this, that I think that dams in the future are likely to be more important for flood control than they are energy. I think it's been pretty amazing some of the new technologies that are coming out. Like we had talked a little bit on the phone, and there was an article I read a few months back about researchers coming out of MIT, and they've basically been testing E. coli bacteria, and they found that these E. coli bacteria, when they bioengineered it, genetically engineered, they were able to have these E. coli produce electricity. And that was because the E. coli were kicking out neutrons, but basically the E. coli interacting with water vapor produced electricity. So my hunch is that we're going to be sitting here in 10 to 20 years and dams and clean power, that's probably going to be obsolete. You know, the next technological frontier, I think, is in front of us, which is ways to produce cheap power without damming rivers. But I do agree that, look, some of these dams are in place because you've got lots of people living below them. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Those dams are not going to come out because they provide flood protection. And there's dams that are in place for agriculture in places where that's the only way these people are going to get water to their crops. And so my hunch is that a lot of, you know, there's going to be a number of dams that stay in. But I also think we're looking here at 100 years, and I think that we're going to look back on a lot of these dams and go, I can't believe we didn't remove them sooner.
Right.
Because I do think this will remain divisive, right? I mean, it's not like we're humans, and we're Americans, for one. So that means we disagree on lots of things. So my hunch is that for dam removal to be successful, you've got to take care of the humans as well as the fish.
Yeah. I mean, if you look at any large infrastructure projects that have happened over the years, when the U.S. built their freeway system, I mean, that displaced a lot of people. It ran through people's property. They had to literally move houses, rebuild houses. So it's not that it can't be done, you know, and those interstates span across the entire country. And so to say like, oh, we can't move a dam because there's a bunch of houses down there. It's like, well, you know, maybe not right now, but in my opinion, you know, if we had a magic wand to just wave around and make the world a perfect place, I think taking the dams out would make sense. Unfortunately, we don't have any magic wands, and the world will never be a perfect place.
Yeah.
But I still think we should work towards trying to make it better if we can. Not just for us. I mean, we got to look at people and make sure people are taken care of. But our natural resources, at least to me, are you know, right there as a close second, and obviously people depend on natural resources, so having them as healthy as possible is key. But yeah, it's always,
yeah, I think you crushed it.
It's interesting to get your take on that, you know, you being from the West Coast, very, very different than where I am here in Michigan, but there's all kinds of dam removal projects going on. Granted, you know, I would argue a lot of ours are just due to the fact that the dams are going to fall apart eventually because they're old mill pond dams and whatnot.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
And some of them have, and that can be catastrophic for fish. You know, they're just unmanaged sitting there for 100 years because it used to be a mill pond, and then all of a sudden it washes out and devastates the river for years to come. Not to say that they don't come back, but it's but then there's other places I look at, you know, and there's some of my favorite places to fish, and I'm like, man, if they took that dam out, it sure would change that, you know, forever. It would, it wouldn't be the same river anymore, and I wouldn't be catching those fish that I love to catch there. So it's a catch-22. I get both sides of it. But I will say, you know, you take a river like the Pere Marquette, and that is a river that has zero dams on it now. It's been quite some time, but they've removed all of them. The whole river system's naturally free flowing. And I believe, you know, at least any of the major tributaries in it are as well. There's some little creeks and stuff that I know still have dams on them, but there's no dams there. And then they also have not planted steelhead there in many, 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 many years. And that's one of our healthiest fisheries. So, you know, you look at that and you go, okay, short term, if they take this dam out, it might ruin some of my favorite brown trout fishing, which sucks. But long term, you look at what a river system can be, and it can be naturally sustaining to, you know, multiple fish species that weren't even native here in the first place is pretty incredible.
I think you nailed it, man. I mean, look, and there's plenty of places in the interior west where trout fisheries are based upon cool water releases from dams. And, you know, it is. It's just a right trade-off. And I tend to think that, we all value different things. And my perspective, you know, is one that's like, man, I just love free-flowing rivers and having fish. You know, that's what I love. But some people out here, like we've had increasingly numbers of people who like to catch the walleye and the bass that I'm not very interested in, you know?
Yeah.
Things change, man. And it's going to be an interesting future to see what it holds. You know, what I really hope for is that, you know, there's other generations of people like you and I land in. They're going to wake up on a Saturday morning, be excited to maybe go out and fish with their dad, mom, and get a steelhead or brown trout, and we can continue that heritage, you know, of anglers throughout North America loving to be on rivers. And then hopefully we can also be smart enough to set aside some of our very best last places, you know,
yeah,
to maintain
absolutely.
Them at the very least as museum pieces until we can figure out how to fix the population problem, you know, and live as we need to live. You know, I mean, whatever happens, but I want us fishing, man.
Yeah.
And
something
at the same time. Yeah.
That's something I think anybody listening to the podcast would agree with. We all want to be fishing and we all love catching fish. Otherwise, none of us would be listening to this or talking on it right now. But it's the whole world of fishing and hunting, especially. It's so much more political than I ever realized, you know, growing up. When I was a kid, you know, we threw the boat in the lake and we went fishing and we caught fish. The DNR was just somebody that gave you a ticket if you didn't have your license on you. And unfortunately, I think there's a lot of grown adults that kind of look at it that way. And it's so important to just educate yourself on what's actually going on in your state, no matter where you live, you know, whether it's in Florida or Michigan or Montana, it doesn't matter. There's always important issues going on that you might have an opinion on that differs from what's actually going on. So it's, you know, understanding the different, the different programs that are going on, the different restoration programs, hatcheries, you name it. It's just good to be informed and know what's going on. And that way you can at least add input to the situation and say, I support this or I don't support it. And the government is there to listen to that kind of stuff too. So I stress that a lot, you know, pay attention to what's going on, right? Figure out who the elected officials are that you need to write into to support or oppose something. Because we all do have a voice, even though sometimes it doesn't feel that way. You know, every voice does matter on these types of issues.
Yeah. Well said, Landon. Well said, man. You know, we're all better off informed. It not only makes it easier to communicate, it makes it easier to disagree and find compromise when we do disagree, you know?
Yep. Exactly. And I guess this is a good segue. Speaking of being informed, especially for West Coast anglers out there, you've got your own podcast now. When I started listening to it, I think you had 6 episodes out, and I binge listened those, and I'm sure you've got some more out now that I can listen to. How's that going? Before we're already over an hour here, and we've both got some other things to get to. So if you got it, 5 minutes, tell people about your podcast, where they can find it, what it's about, and why they should listen to it.
Sure. Well, thanks, Landon. And, I must admit, doing the podcast with you and a couple other people kind of, had me thinking it's really fun just to help educate people and talk about fish and biology and conservation and management. So, yeah, I am currently doing a podcast on the Barbless platform. So if you go to Barbless Company or barbless.co/OP podcast, mine is called the OP Fishing Podcast. You can find it on Apple or any of them. Basically, what I'm trying to do is, I'm a scientist, but I'm also an angler, and I really just want to help share information that I've been able to pick up both through my own work and that I've learned from other people, professors, other anglers. And I just want to share that information to help inform anglers out there so that they have the best information they can to make the decisions that they want to make. And then they can also inform themselves in a way that I'd like to say isn't biased. I mean, we all have our biases, right? Like, I'm as biased as anybody is inside as a human being, but I like to provide a diverse perspective. So I'm trying to always bring in college professors and folks like that can give kind of the more hardcore objective science point of view, and then also trying to bring in anglers like a Bill Herzog or folks like that have been fishing a long time and bring their perspective. I want folks to have a good time listening, but I want them to come away feeling as though they learned something, right, and that they hopefully can apply that. I should also mention that I do some of the podcasts solo, and in those podcasts, or with a friend of mine, Nick Chambers, and in those cases, I'm mostly talking like tactics. So I collect a lot of data as an angler, and I, fish a lot. So a number of my episodes are about basically how do you collect the right information to make you a better angler and then apply it to the place where you live. So trying to talk about those things, but you're right, a lot of it is about the West Coast, and I just feel really fortunate to have had some good guests to start. Landon, of course, I want to have you on there at some point to return the favor, brother.
Yeah, well, I don't know if I'll be quite as insightful as you are. I'm a better question asker than I am an answerer, but I'd love to be on. We'll stick to talking about just fishing, I'll ask you some questions on more of the scientific stuff. But no doubt, you need to get out here and come to Michigan too sometime and see what you think of our lake run rainbow trout, aka steelhead, like we call them. And I'd really want to get I want to get some West Coast guys out here and get some steelhead on the end of the line and say, did that feel like a steelhead or no? And vice versa, I need to get out there, and I'd love to do some of that coastal steelhead fishing in that beautiful turquoise water you guys have and rainforest. And it's going to happen eventually. I guess before we cut this off, if I had to pick one time to come out there and target steelhead, let's say I'm going to plan a trip, what's the best time to go out west and target coastal rainforest steelhead?
Well, if you want coastal rainforest steelhead, I'm going to March is your safest bet for traveling that far. That's the peak of the season, and you have a lot less rainfall. If you try and come in January and February, you have a much higher chance of getting one of our epic 9-inch rainfall days, and the river goes up from, really clear to chocolate mud. So I think March is the best time if you want winter steelhead. If you want summer runs, you want to go to a place like the Columbia, the best time for that tends to be in the fall. But August isn't bad, but I like September, early October, middle of October. So those are the two times a year that are kind of my favorites to be alive with a steelheader on the West Coast. And I would love to have you out, man. And I've got to get out there. So we definitely have to get out there and do this together, kind of do a fish swap.
Yeah, that would be fun. Do a compare and contrast, and hopefully get on fish in both places so we can, because that's always the struggle with steelhead too. You can go somewhere for a week and it just isn't the right week to be there, even if you thought it was.
it makes sense, but I'm excited to see what you guys got. I mean, I'm excited to see those fish. I know a couple of my friends keep pestering me. I've got to get out there. When I do, I'll definitely make a trip and stop by and see you, because it's just fun. It's fun to see fish in different places.
For sure. Yeah, you know, I don't even care what species it is. Just going to a new place and catching something new is, like, that's what I live for, you know. Is even if it's somewhere in Michigan, you know, just going to a different river and catching, you know, the same old 10-inch brown trout out of a different stream, you learn something every time you go someplace new and fish with somebody new, and people that isolate themselves completely from fishing with other people, which, don't get me wrong, I fish alone at least 75% of the time. But I fish with people a lot too. And that's where I really have learned most of what I know. I mean, you're going to learn from fishing by yourself, but you know, you're going to learn twice as much fishing with other people, I think. So, and
I think it's a great point. I tend to learn a lot from watching others, and then I go back to fish by myself to hone it. You know,
exactly. Yep, exactly. That's how I look at it as well. Well, I've actually got to jump on a board call here for Backcountry Hunters and Anglers. We got our monthly call. It started here at 8. So, man, I could sit here and chat with you about this stuff for hours. It was really nice to have you back on the show. We'll definitely should make it an annual thing, and we could kind of talk about you know, each year and what you're seeing and how things are changing. Hopefully next year we talk and things have improved. But I think it would just be really cool to kind of to document in these podcasts just what's going on out there, and could go back and listen to them throughout the years and say, oh, I remember that terrible run. Glad to see we're back to double that now.
Yeah, let's do it, dude. I enjoy this, and thank you for all, you know, just making me more aware of podcasting in general, dude.
Yeah.
Appreciate it. You do a great job.
Well, appreciate it, man. Thanks so much, and have a great night.
You too. Thanks, Lyman. Bye-bye.
Yep. Bye.